Luke chapter 24. Luke 24. There are a lot of verses we could read today, I suppose. Thank you very much. I always like the Gospel of John. Of course, you know the book of John is my favorite. I love reading from that, I suppose, more than any other book in the Bible. Not that I don't enjoy the other books, but I love the Gospel of John. I love it in John chapter 20, when Mary Magdalene is standing there crying, and Jesus is standing there. The Bible says she supposed that he was the gardener, said unto him, "Sir, if thou hast taken him away, tell me where thou hast borne him, that I may go there." And Jesus says this. He says one word, "Mary." And she looks at him through tear-swollen eyes. She recognizes Jesus for who he is. Says, "Master." Falls at him. To me, that is some of the most poignant words in the Bible, when he just says to her, "Mary." I had a sermon a long time ago, "When God Calls Your Name." There are instances in the Bible where God calls people by name. He called Samuel by name. He called Samuel. He called Mary by name. But this morning we're in Luke chapter 24. Luke 24. Let's stand, shall we? We'll just read a few verses today in Luke chapter 24. It says, "Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices with them that they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them," I love this, "Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered unto the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all these things unto the 11 and to all the rest." It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Then arose Peter and ran into the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at that which was come to pass. And let's pray. Now, Father, again, we thank you for another Sunday morning. Lord, I suppose not just another Sunday morning, but a Sunday morning in which we celebrate the resurrection of Christ. And Lord, I suppose we could say that every Sunday ought to be a resurrection Sunday, and that we celebrate the resurrection of Christ from the dead. Father, I pray again today. Lord, you know what my prayer is, Lord, that you'll help me. As always, Lord, as always, I need your help. Lord, I absolutely need your help. Lord, I figured out a long time ago it's not the preacher. And so, Lord, I pray that you'll help me today. And Lord, I pray for every single person in this room. Lord, whether they've been here 1,000 times, 500 times, first time, Lord, whatever. Lord, I pray for them today. Lord, I pray that they might find meaning into their life. Lord, I pray for anyone who may be here today. Lord, I think the simplest way I know how to say it is, if there's someone here today that has some doubt about where they would go if they died today, if they have any doubt about that at all, Lord, help them to see that life eternal is the free gift of God given to any and to all who will receive it. Lord, I thank you for that day. Lord, I remember the date, March 16th. Lord, I thank you for that day. And Lord, I'm sure that there are multitudes of others there. Lord, they may not remember the date, but they remember. Lord, for that one who may not. Oh God, oh Holy Spirit of God, speak to the heart. Lord, we pray, Lord, thy presence would be here. Lord, again, I lift up those who can't be here. Lord, I know that there have been so many sick in the church this week and just unable to be here. And so, Lord, we pray, Lord, for those who may be ill today, can't be in church. Lord, I pray that you would help them and, Lord, bring them back to be with us soon. Again, Father, I thank you, Lord, for this privilege. Lord, it is a privilege to stand before these people. Lord, it is a humbling experience to stand before these people. Lord, I pray that you'll help me again today. Bless us, we ask, in these few moments. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. You may be seated. If I were to ask, probably some of you could tell me from memory, where I lived as a kid. It was 51, 52. I still see the place, Wright Avenue. My brother and I were talking about it the other day. I asked him if he remembered anything about that place. And I think we were like 10 years, I was like 11, 10 years old, something like that, when we moved out of Baltimore. And he would have been about 8 years old. He said he remembers a few things about it. I remember this. I remember a few things about living there. I remember that we rarely, if ever, went to church. Now, we may have went to church on Easter. My parents, my mother was somewhat religious, and we may have went to church on Easter, but that really isn't what I remember about Easter at all. I can remember going to the store with Mom, and I can remember her buying, I can see the name of that company that sells the Easter egg dye. Anybody, what was that? What? Todd? Oh, yeah, that's it right there. Anyway, so, and I can remember going to the store with Mom and buying it, and I can remember coming home, and I remember, I think you boil water and put vinegar in it, right? Yeah, that's the way it is, because I remember this vinegar stank. I can remember that. And I can remember doing that, and boy, you got the old wax crayon out, and you would write on the Easter, on the eggs, and then you would dip them in the dye, and, you know, then the name would come out, et cetera, et cetera. And that's what I remember about Easter. I do remember waking up on Easter, whatever it may have been, and I can remember there would always be a big Easter basket out there, and there would always be one big chocolate rabbit. I mean, we're talking the giant, I would say the giant economy size, but if you say that, that is redundant. But anyway, the giant, the really big chocolate rabbit, and then all kinds of jelly beans, and then there would be some of the dyed eggs in there, and there might be a smaller chocolate rabbit, and the things that I always liked was those marshmallow chickens. Man, I love those marshmallow chickens. And you would think that somebody would buy me some of those, but no. But that's what I remember. That's what I remember about Easter. I don't ever really remember ever going to... I'm serious about it. In this, I really don't ever remember even going to church on Easter. I really don't even remember that. Now, that in and of itself is a crime. It's a shame because, like Christmas, Christmas is not about, you know, Santa Claus, and Christmas is not about the Easter Bunny. I suppose when I got a little older, I began to rationalize in my mind, how was it possible I might be able to, you know, figure out how a fat man got down a chimney, but how was it possible that the Easter Bunny would bring around all these Easter baskets to all these kids? After a while, that didn't make sense at all, but I still like marshmallow chicken. But anyway, it's like, and Easter had absolutely no meaning to me. It had no meaning to me until my dad got saved. And then we started going to church, because you'll remember that I've told you this story many times, that I didn't like going to church, didn't want to go to church. I was going to tell Dad I wasn't going to go to church anymore. He didn't go to church. I wasn't going to go to church. I didn't want my dad. I told somebody this the other day. I did not want my dad to know who my friends were. I didn't want my mom to know who my friends were. I was having a good time enjoying life, or as I thought. And then dad got saved. And that changed our lives. I mean, that changed our lives. And then for the first time in my life, I realized, I understood what Easter's about. When we read there in Luke chapter 24, I love the verse where it says, "He is not here, but he is risen." He is not here, he is risen. Why seek ye the living among the dead? Don't you remember what he said? Don't you remember that while he was with you in Galilee, he said that he had to be crucified and that he'd be buried, but 3 days later he would arise from the dead. And they went back to town. I'm sure that those women were pretty excited about what those two angels said. Luke says this. He says it also in the book of Acts. He says this when Jesus arose, that two men appeared, said, "Ye men of Galilee." He says here in the Gospel of Luke that two men, but we know them to be angels. And they went back into town, and the apostles were there, and they were all excited about it. And boy, they were all worked up about it. And they said, "Hey, he's not dead. He is alive." And this is what, you know, those disciples, boy, they threw some cold water on it right away. The Bible says it seemed as idle tales to them. It was something that they made up. Now, there are several false ideas. Now, I want to give you, in the time that we have, I've got like 10 things. And if I took each one for 5 minutes, we'd be here for 50 minutes. So let me hurry if I can. If I can, you know I can't, but if I can. So there are several ideas about what didn't happen. The first one is this, that Jesus wasn't really crucified on the cross, that he merely passed out. And there are people, I read the book, it was called The Passover Plot. It was written by a preacher, and in that he maintains that Christ did not really die on the cross, but that he merely passed out. That is what happened. That when he was on the cross, he fainted. Now, that does not take into account the fact that he was beaten by the Roman soldiers, who were pretty good at what they did. They beat him. When they cut a man down, he did not get up. That's why it says that they took him to Pilate after they beat him. They took him because he was beaten mercilessly by the Roman soldiers. So to say that he passed out, but that still doesn't take into account the idea that when they beat him about the head with a stick, the Bible says it was a reed, but it was probably some kind of a stick. They beat him about the head. They blindfolded him. They said, "If thou be the Son of God, prophesy who hit you." They took those Syrian thorns about that long, made that crown of thorns, platted it, and shoved it down upon his head. Now, that doesn't include the cross. I said Wednesday night, you know, we have a thing in America about cruel and unusual punishment. I'm telling you that the Romans were good at crucifixion, and brother, it was unusual, and I'm telling you, it was meant to be cruel. You say, "Well, why were they like that?" Because Pete Fitzgerald is standing down there at the bottom of the cross, and he's watching those guys die, and he's thinking to himself, "I don't know what those guys did, but I sure don't want to do that because I don't want to wind up there." When they took Jesus out, you say, "Well, Simon the Cyrene had helped him." Absolutely. Why? Because he was so weak from the loss of blood. I'm telling you that when the Romans beat him, they beat him mercilessly. They beat him till the skin was ripped away from the muscle, and the muscle was ripped away from the tendon, and he bled. I read someplace, I don't know where, that people beaten by the Romans, many did not survive the beating. So now Simon is carrying that cross out. He staggers under the weight of it. Simon carries it out. He gets out to the cross, and they take those nails, and they drive them through his feet. You ever run a nail through your, run a nail in your foot, you step on a board or something, and oh man, that thing. You're hopping around like, you know, you're doing a fly swat dip or whatever, and it hurts, but not with Jesus. They drove the nails through the top of his feet. I read this somewhere that the Romans, they were good at what they did. They stretched his arms out at a 90-degree angle, drove nails through here trying to hit the nerve so that the pain would be more excruciating. And then they put you up on that cross. And then you push yourself up down, because at 90 degrees, you would let yourself down to 65, because the pain going through your feet, through your entire body, was excruciating, and you would let yourself down. And when you let yourself down, your arms then came to a 65-degree angle, and then you began to suffocate. That is obvious from the fact that they broke those other guys' legs, and they quickly suffocated. But you're on the cross, and you don't want to suffocate. You'll do anything to stay alive, so you push yourself back up, and the pain becomes excruciating again. You let yourself down and you begin to suffocate again. Now you think about that. A back that had been beaten, now you're on that old rugged cross and you're pushing yourself up and down. Up and down on that cross, trying to breathe, trying to let go of the pain, trying to breathe. For hours he did that. Now, he merely fainted, this guy said. That doesn't take into the account that a Roman soldier came and thrust a spear up into his side. You say, well, he might have survived the cross. Yeah, right. But he wouldn't have survived that spear up into his side. So the first idea about what didn't happen was, well, he merely passed out. And when they put him in the tomb, he lost a tremendous amount of blood, had his hands pierced, his side pierced, his feet pierced. They put him in that tomb. They put him in there. And after a few days in that tomb, he revived. Now, not only did he revive, but he rolled that big stone away, and then he beat the Roman soldiers up and got away. That is stupid that happened. Not only that, but some people said they saw him. There's a second idea that he didn't really die on the cross. The second idea was that he did die on the cross, but that he did not rise from the dead, and people were having hallucinations. Now, I could understand if one person had a hallucination. I could understand that. We could understand that if individually, because usually, two people together don't have the same hallucination. You understand what I'm saying? Well, let's say that Dave and Bella, she had a hallucination. And Dave goes, man, I see the same thing you're seeing. Now, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. Now, it might be one thing if she did. But you know what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15? That he was seen of over 500 people at one time after the crucifixion. 500 people saw Jesus alive. Paul says this, basically this, when he talks about the resurrection, he said, if you don't believe me, go ask those 500 people. So there's the he passed out theory, there was the hallucination theory that people were just hallucinating. They were so overcome with grief, so overcome with sorrow, so overcome with tears that they thought they saw Jesus, but they didn't really see him. They did not really see him. Thirdly, this. The guy that they did see was not really Jesus, but he was an impersonator. It was somebody who was dressed up like Jesus. It wasn't really Jesus. Jesus is dead, did not arise from the dead. And this guy went around posing as Jesus. Now, there have been a lot of imposters through the centuries. I know nobody in here remembers Lenin, Vladimir Lenin, not John Lennon, but Vladimir Lenin. Nobody's in here old enough to remember him, are they? I don't think so. I think he died in 1924. He made this statement. I am the risen Son of God. I am the risen Son of God. Of course, he's dead. He's over there in Lenin's tomb over there. Hey, who's in Lenin's tomb? I don't know. Lenin is. But look, he's been dead since 1924. Somebody said, well, it was an imposter. It wasn't really Jesus. And there are a lot of good imposters, people who can inflect their voice in such a way that you would, if you did not see them, would say, well, that is somebody different. And no, they're saying that it was an imposter that went around and said, I am Jesus, I am resurrected. I just look different because I was crucified and was, but it's really me. It really is me. an imposter. Fourthly, some suggest that it's a spiritual resurrection. Now, the problem with that is this. Now, if Jesus wanted to hedge his bet, if we could say it like that, he could have said, I will spiritually rise from the dead. Now, anybody can say that. Anybody can say, well, you know what? I'm going to be dead, but I'm going to spiritually rise from the dead. Jesus expressly said this. As the angel reminded those women, don't you remember when he was with you in Galilee and he said that he must be crucified and that 3 days later he would arise from the dead? Don't you remember that? Oh, yeah, we remember that. Jesus expressly said that he would bodily rise from the dead. So to say, well, it was a spiritual resurrection. Yeah, we believe that Jesus was the Son of God, but that he only spiritually rose from the dead. That would make Jesus a liar because he said, I will rise again. He said this, destroy this temple in 3 days, I will raise it up. The spiritual resurrection has absolutely no bearing. It's a Christ hater's way out. Fifthly, this, that they went to the wrong tomb. Jesus is really dead, but they went to the wrong. Now the problem with this, the Roman soldiers knew where he was buried, and Joseph of Arimathea knew where he was buried, and Nicodemus knew where he was buried, and those women knew where he was buried, because it says this, that while Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea were preparing the body to put it in the tomb, the women sat over there watching where they put him. They went to the wrong tomb that morning. That still didn't explain the fact that a stone was rolled away. What happened to the guy that was in that tomb? Well, there wasn't anybody really buried in there yet, preacher. Another thought is, somebody stole him. Somebody stole the body of Jesus. Now, to steal the body of Jesus, you realize what would have to happen. You'd have to get past the Roman soldiers. Now, there was a guard out there. How many were out there? It was not probably four. If it was like with the other ones in the book of Acts, there were probably four soldiers watching it. Not only were the four soldiers watching it, but it was sealed with a Roman seal. Not only were the Roman soldiers watching it, but the weight of Rome was behind that tomb. Not only that, but I'm sure that some of those Pharisees, where they were out there watching too, because they said this imposter said that if he was buried and died and buried, that the third day would arise. And they said, so to make this situation even more worse, put somebody out there. Yeah, more worse. Worser. Yeah, there we go. Don't make it any worser than what it is. More worse. I don't know what it is. Better, best. But anyway, you better put somebody out there. They knew where the tomb was. They knew where it was. Now, for somebody to steal it, the body, for someone to steal the body, and this is one of the theories. One of the false theories is that, well, the body was stolen. That Jesus is really still dead and that they just came and they stole it. They had to get by the Roman soldiers. And you think about this, about the disciples. Because in chapter 24, where we just read, they were all sitting in a room. They were afraid. And they didn't believe. They did not believe. They did not believe. They did not believe. They thought it was an idle tale. Now, let me give you five things. Five down, five to go. Let me give you five reasons to believe in the resurrection. Our whole hope, everything that you and I is based upon the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Paul said this. Paul actually said this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that if Christ is not risen, then your faith is in vain. And you may as well throw it all away. If Christ is not risen. If one of those things that I've just mentioned, he passed out, or an impersonator was going around, he's still dead, they stole the body, hid the body somewhere, they were hallucinating. If one of those things is true, then pal, we're packing tomorrow, and we're moving out of here before it snows again. Amen? And if you're smart, you'll come with me. Amen? She's the only one, but anyway. If Christ be not risen, then our faith is in vain. If Christ is not alive, if he did not literally rise from the dead. Now, people say this. Well, what is so important about Jesus rising from the dead? What's so important about that? Now, the first thing is this. Why is it that you and I ought to believe that Jesus is alive? Why should we believe that he literally 3 days later, upon the first day of the week? Now, the Jewish day ended at 6 o'clock sundown, so sometime or other after 6 o'clock, Saturday night, Jesus arose from the dead. Now, he didn't have to roll the stone away. He didn't have to beat the soldiers up. Listen, the stone was rolled away simply to show there wasn't anybody in there. Jesus was long gone. Why should I believe in the resurrection? Why is it that, as we say, we're believers in Christ, why is it? What's so important about the resurrection? The importance of the resurrection is this. Somebody had to die for sins. Now, we mentioned in Sunday school, and we've talked about this in Sunday school, and we brought this up in Sunday school, about Christ dying for our sins, Christ paying for our sins that on the cross. And he paid for our sins on the cross. He paid for our sins on the cross. And that he was buried and that he rose again the third day. Well, the Bible says this, that he suffered once in the end of the world to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. It was necessary for Jesus to die. And without the shedding of blood, the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Jesus hung on that cross, suffered and bled and died to pay, as John the Baptist said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." Jesus died on the cross to pay for my sins, your sins, the sins of the world. Now, the universalist says this. Well, if Jesus paid for all the sins of the world, then I guess everybody's going to heaven. Jesus' death was that substitutionary death, the substitutionary atonement. That's what we believe. We believe that Christ died on the cross, paid for the sins of the whole world, paid for my sins, paid for your sins, all of my dirty, rotten, no good stuff that I've done in my life. Jesus paid that. But if Jesus had not arisen from the dead when he died, what is the significance of the resurrection? The significance of the resurrection is this. God is saying this. I'm satisfied now that sins have been paid for, and in the resurrection says that I accept what Jesus did on the cross to pay for the sins of the world. Now, if you stop and think about it for a moment, how could one man pay for it? Well, he just wasn't any ordinary man. He was the God-man, Jesus come in the flesh. Jesus came, died for us, paid for our sins. God said, I'm satisfied that sins have been paid for. Now, if one of those five things that I spoke about is true, if one of those things was true, he passed out and revived. Doesn't explain how he got out of the tomb. Doesn't explain how he got healed, blah, blah, blah. They were hallucinating. Doesn't explain 500 people. Well, there was an imposter. I think the disciples would have known him. Look, if one of those five things were true, what it would say then is this. God is not satisfied for the payment of sins, and that men are still lost in their sins, and men are still going to die and go to hell. But now, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, but now is Christ risen from the dead. Christ is risen from the dead. So you say, well, preacher, what proof is there that Jesus rose from the dead? What kind of proof is there that Jesus literally rose from the dead? Well, number one is this. Why should we believe in the resurrection? The first thing is this. They went out to the tomb that day, and the tomb was empty. There wasn't anybody there. There wasn't anybody at that tomb. Now, you say, well, what's that supposed to mean? Just this. And I've said this before. You know, the Jews hated Jesus. They hated him. They despised him. They couldn't stand him. They crucified him. Caiaphas said, look, it's needful for one person to die, and they chose Jesus. They said that's where the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, the Herodians, all those people, they hated Jesus. And they thought, let's crucify him and get him out of the way. They hated him. Now, don't you think that if they would have stolen the body, and I would suggest this to you, doesn't say it in the Bible, but I would suggest this to you. Don't you think that they looked for the body of Jesus? Don't you think, they stole it away. Let's just call it a win. We have no need to look for it. They stole it, probably hid it somewhere. That made the matter worse. Don't you think, the authority of Rome is now called into question. Because the Pilate sealed the tomb. The authority of Rome and the Roman soldiers were there. And to say, well, they beat the soldiers up, they broke the seal of Rome, and they stole the body away. Don't you think that somebody would have been looking for that? I'll guarantee you that Rome looked for the body. I'll guarantee you that the Sadducees and the Pharisees and the religious crowd, they're all looking for that body. All you gotta do is produce the body, and you've killed Christianity. Because listen, You can't explain from the crucifixion until Pentecost. We'll just say Pentecost. You can't explain that. You can't explain what happened. There's no explanation for it other than the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Why is it that we should believe in the resurrection? One, because there was nobody in that tomb. Nobody there. All we got to do is find a body. Look, we got to find that body. We have got to find that body. If we can find that body, we will put to rest this idea about Christianity. You can't explain the explosion that occurs other than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Why should we believe in the empty tomb? Well, because there was nobody there. Somebody wrote a song, nobody's there. Jesus rose up from the dead. He isn't there since that resurrection day. Listen, since Jesus arose, he arose physically from the dead. All you got to do is produce a body. They could not do that. I know they would have looked and looked and looked and looked, but they couldn't. Why is it that we ought to believe in the resurrection? Because the tomb was empty and they never found the body of Jesus anywhere. Now, I would think, how many remember Jim Jones? Remember Jim Jones down there in Ghana? That's where it was. Remember, they were somewhere here in the United States, and they all picked up and moved to Ghana. Now, if I said, everybody, let's move to Ghana, you better have some second thoughts about that. But anyway, it's like they all moved down there. They all followed that guy. They thought that guy was fantastic. They thought, he was God come back. And they followed him to Ghana. And when the government, United States government, they sent some people down there. They shot a senator up or a congressman and some others got away. You remember what happened. They made everybody drink the Kool-Aid. And they all died. So did Jim Jones's movement. They're nobody's at Jonesboro anymore, what they called it. Nobody's there. Jim Jones died. And when he died, so did the movement that he was leading. Jesus died. Now, normally, when there is a leader of a movement and that person dies, that's it. Jesus died. They buried him. And the third day they went over there and there wasn't anybody at that tomb. There was nobody there. Nobody there. Secondly, we got hurt. Not only that, not only was the tomb empty, but look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15 for a minute. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15. Look at that for a moment. Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. 1 Corinthians 15. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we find Paul writing. Paul wrote this book. Paul wrote 1 Corinthians about 20 years after the resurrection. Now, despite what some may think, they didn't walk down to Kmart one day and there was the Bible all together. The Bible did not come into, as we know it, to about 100 AD. Somewhere around there they began to compile it, the Syrian Bible. But Paul wrote this about 20 years after Jesus arose from the dead. Now, originally, all this was, 1 Corinthians, all 1 Corinthians was, it was not a book of the Bible. All it was a letter. It was a letter that Paul wrote to the Corinthians telling them about what happened. Now, 20 years later, probably most of the Corinthians at that church there, most of them weren't at Jerusalem when the crucifixion occurred, when the resurrection occurred. And so Paul wrote them a letter, and a letter is considered to be evidence in a trial. If you write a letter, say, I'm going to kill my wife, and they find that letter with your wife dead, you're probably going to have some problems. When Paul wrote this letter of 1 Corinthians, the letter is used as evidence. Now notice what he says in verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. That he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to Scripture, and that he was seen of. Now notice, the Gospels in verse 3 and 4. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. Verse 5. That it was seen of Cephas. Cephas was Simon Peter. That's who that was. Then of the 12, the first appearance that Jesus had to Peter, the Bible does not say about what it was about. When it occurred, where it occurred, the Bible does not say that. All it does is tell us here that it was seen of Peter. Then of the 12, Peter saw him. Peter never mentions it in his two books that he wrote. The two letters that Peter wrote, he doesn't mention this occurrence when he saw Jesus. Paul just simply says that Peter saw him, that he did see him. Then he was seen of the 12. You'll remember that night when he was when they were in the upper room and they thought, oh, these women are crazy, they don't know what they're talking about. Jesus appeared to them that night. He passed right through the door. And Jesus said, touch me, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones. Now, 1 Corinthians 15 does not give all the instances. For example, in chapter 24 of Luke, after what we read, two disciples are on their way to Emmaus. They didn't steal the body. They're on their way back home. Cleopas and his wife, Mary, they're on their way back home, and Jesus appears to them. They see him. Again, if you have a hallucination, that's one thing. But to have the person standing next to you have the same hallucination, that's something entirely different. And so he was seen of those two. But notice what else it says there, that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain. And if you're reading between the lines, again, Paul says this, if you don't believe what I said about Christ being risen from the dead, go ask these guys, because the bigger part of them are still alive. 20 years later, they're still alive, and they will still attest to the fact that Jesus arose. After that, he was seen of James. James's brother, or James the disciple. Then of all the apostles. Last of all, he was seen of me as one born out of due time. You cannot discredit the post crucifixion appearances of Jesus. Now, if one of you said, I saw so-and-so, I said, well, he died. Yeah, I know, but I saw him. Well, did anybody else see him? No, nobody else saw him. You're the only one that saw him. But you saw him. Yeah, I saw him. Yeah, I'm confident of the fact I saw him. We would say that probably there's something wrong with you. So-and-so is dead. He is dead. You did not see him. You thought you saw him. Sometimes people do have hallucinations. One of the times I hurt my back, and it was pitiful. Oh, it was pitiful. I'm laying in bed. I can't get up, and I'm taking drugs, and I'm laying there, and I'm feeling good. And my father calls on the phone. He wants to know how I'm doing. I'm doing good. I'm doing good, Dad. Now, I can't get out of bed, but I'm doing good, Dad. I'm doing really good. And I can't even roll over in bed. I'm doing good, Dad. I'm doing great. I hang up. 10 minutes later, Carol comes into the room and says, I said to her, where's Dad at? She goes, what do you mean, where's Dad at? He's in Florida. No, he's not. I said, 10 minutes ago, he was standing right there talking to me. I saw him. You didn't see your father. He's in Florida. Now, person has a hallucination. Okay. But not 500 people. She didn't see him. When I said he's right here in the room, well, I didn't see him. But if we said, if in this room today, in church today, all folks said, man, we saw so-and-so and they were alive, we would probably have to take into strong consideration that the person they saw was really alive. It's post-crucifixion. Thirdly, this. Why should I believe? Notice what it says there in that verse when Paul writes this. Last of all, he was seen of me also as one born out of due time. The Apostle Paul is a unique individual. He was born about 5 AD. Now, Christ was born probably 3-4 BC. Paul was born around 5 AD. So, in 30 AD, when we feel like that, we're pretty confident of that, in April of 30 AD, that Christ was crucified, Paul was already under the study of Gamaliel, the brilliant Jewish lawyer. Paul was already on his way to becoming a Pharisee, and he did become a Pharisee. He was already on his way to that. Paul is brilliant. He's very smart. Paul probably is a man of wealth. Paul is somebody that he was the it guy. He was the guy that had everything. I mean, he was on his way to becoming somebody who was somebody in Jewish society. That's where Paul was headed. He was wealthy. He was brilliant. He was somebody that was an authority. You remember when Stephen was stoned to death? Paul was standing there, called Saul, of course, at that time. Saul is standing there, and he consented to the death of Stephen. I cannot help but believe that at the age of 25, that Saul of Tarsus must have been familiar and maybe possibly at the Passover in Jerusalem when Jesus was crucified. He's called himself a Pharisee of the Pharisee. He was at the top of the ladder, on the top rung, as far as being somebody of wealth and position and station in life. And all he had to do was keep on going in the direction he was going. That was it. That's all he had to do. But for some reason, he threw all that away. Notice in 2 Corinthians, if you would, in chapter 11. Paul threw all that, everything away, 2 Corinthians 11. Now notice, 2 Corinthians 11, notice. Now remember, Paul was the it guy. He was the guy that had everything going for him. But he threw it all away. Say, preacher, why did he do that? Notice in 2 Corinthians 11, I'm sorry. Here Paul describes his life. Beginning in verse 23. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more, and labor's more abundant. And stripes above measure. What's that mean? It means he was beaten like Jesus was beaten. In prison, more frequent, and death's off. of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Five times he said he was beaten with a whip 39 times. Now I'm telling you, they did not keep track. You might can imagine one beating 39 times with a leather whip. But can you imagine being beaten five times, 39 times? Now, you're the guy that is voted most likely to succeed in high school. You're the guy that's going to get ahead, and you throw all of that away to be beaten with a whip 39 times, five times. Notice what else. Once I was stoned. If you're reading the book of Acts, when Paul was at Lystra, they stoned him. Then they drug his body outside of town, and they threw it on a dump, and they left him for dead. He was stoned. You ever been, probably not, you ever been, I'm not talking about you were throwing pebbles at one another. When we were kids, you know, we were quite militaristic. We would get dirt clods, and they were hand grenades. You know, you throw them, and they explode. Have you ever been really hitting? Have you ever really been hit by a rock? I mean, really nailed by a rock. I don't know how old it was. I forget how old it was. My cousin Linda was, I don't know, they were harassing me. I mean, they were harassing me. Her and her sisters. And so I picked a rock up and I threw it at them. You know that Longfellow poem, I shot an arrow into the air, where it fell, I know not where, you know that. I just picked the rock up to throw at them to leave me alone. But it caught her fully in the mouth. I remember seeing the blood, and I remember running. Because my Aunt Peggy, she said to me later, she said, Jimmy, she said, I did not say anything to you. Because she said, I figured you had suffered enough. Yeah, I had, yeah. But can you imagine being stoned to the point where they believe that you are dead? I mean, it just wasn't one rock. Traditional stoning, by the way, the Jews did it. They took you outside of town, they put you in a pit, and they put this big rock on top of you so you couldn't breathe. Then they stood over the pit, and they threw rocks down upon you and stoned you to death. I'm not sure that's how they did it with Paul, because then they drug him outside and threw him on the town dump. This is the it guy. This is the guy that has everything going for him. He's been beaten. He has been stoned. Notice what else it says. I was in a shipwreck. I was in the deep. A night and a day have I been in the deep, floating around. And then it goes on and says all this other stuff. And journeyings often in peril and trouble all the time. Wherever Paul went, there seemed to be a riot. Why would he do that? Why would a guy who had everything in life going for him give all that up to eventually, in 64, 66 AD, why would he give all of everything up to have his head chopped off at Nero's request? Back in 1 Corinthians 15, you see the answer. We read it. Let me just read it to you, get back to it or not. Paul says this. He said that, and last of all, he was seen of me also. I saw, Paul says, I saw the resurrected Christ. Why should we believe? As you turn over to Acts chapter 4, why should we believe in the resurrection? Let me give you the last two quickly. Acts chapter 4. Acts 4. This. We should believe the resurrection because of the empty tomb. We should believe the resurrection because of part Christ's appearances afterwards. We should believe the resurrection because of what happened to Paul. We should believe the resurrection in Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4. This is what we read down in verse. Peter is preaching. And he comes down to verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, Neither is there salvation. There's no other way to get to heaven. There's only one way to heaven. We said this morning in Sunday school, hey, you got a lot of confidence in the church, in our church, to get you to heaven? No confidence in this church to get you to heaven. I tell you, this church can't get you to heaven. Now, we can tell you how to get there, but this church, you say, I'd like to be a member of this church. Great. Boy, if I'm just a member of that church, I can go to heaven. No, you can't. No, you can't. Peter says neither is there salvation in any other. There's no other way to heaven. Notice in verse 12. Under heaven, given among men, there is, let me read it to you again. Neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved. There's only one way to heaven. And being a church member is not it. Preacher, I was baptized. So was I. My grandparents, my godparents were my cousin Jack, mom and dad, my uncle Bud, and my aunt Florrie, my dad's sister and brother-in-law. They were my godparents. We have discussed before, we're not really sure what they do. You say, well, you go and live with them if your parents die? Oh, no, that wasn't going to happen. One time, I know I'm a cannibal, but one time I was at my Aunt Florrie's house, and you know how when you get down to the end of your plate, you just kind of scrape everything together in the middle and eat it? She said, I'm going to throw up if you do that again. I said, okay. I was baptized when I was a little baby. I was baptized when I was a little kid. Neither is there salvation in any other. Verse 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. Whoa. In chapter 24 we read about this. That they were sitting there in the upper room. And the door was locked because they were afraid. I said before, you cannot explain the explosion of Christianity apart from the resurrection of Christ. Now, you can't explain the disciples apart from the resurrection of Christ. How can you explain these guys other than Jesus literally arose from the dead? Notice in verse 13. Here's what it says. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. The Pharisees, which had called him in, you know, one time they said, did we not straightly command you not to preach or teach? You intend to bring this man's blood upon us. They sent them aside, and notice in verse 21, so when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing. Another time they beat them. How can you explain the disciples apart from in my mind, look, okay, I got the empty tomb. I got that. I got the post-resurrection appearances of Christ. Okay, I can understand that. I can't understand Paul apart from the resurrection. To me, the thing about the resurrection, the greatest thing about that is you cannot explain those 12 men. You simply cannot explain them. It is impossible. Notice in verse where it said there that they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Now those 12 guys, 11 guys, 12 guys, we'll throw Paul in there. Of course, Judas is dead. Those 12 guys, I have a book, 12 men that turned the world upside down. How can you explain them apart from the resurrection? I've said this before. You may be willing to lie. You may be willing to live for a lie. You may be willing to live for a lie. You know it's a lie. I know it's a lie, but you'll follow that lie. I'm just saying, like socialism. You know what that, pardon me, what one, are there any little kids in here? No. What one idiot said? He said that the Cuban communism is an effort to pull everybody up. That's a lie. You don't pull everybody up under communism. Everybody goes down. But anyway, you may be willing to live for a lie, but you're not willing, you're not going to die for it. Oh, I was just kidding. I don't really believe it. But the apostles, James was killed by the sword. Thomas was shot full of arrows in India. Matthew had spears thrown through him. Philip was tortured, then crucified. Bartholomew was skinned alive. Andrew, James, the less, that is, and Simon were all crucified. How can you explain somebody doing that? If they got together one day and said, you know, Jesus said he was going to rise from the dead, but he didn't really arise from the dead, but let's just say that he did. Just for the sake of argument, we can keep this thing going. We can keep it going. You may be willing to live for a lie, but to be skinned alive for a lie? How do you explain it? You can't. Other than that they saw the resurrected Christ. Lastly, this. Look at Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, 28. Let me give you two verses, and we're through. You can't explain, as I said a few minutes ago, fifthly this. You can't explain what happened after the crucifixion. What happened to those disciples? Look at, if I said chapter 5, I believe verse 28. Now, verse 27, and when they had brought them and they set them before the council and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. How do you explain that? I mean, really, how can you explain that? Why would they do that? How can you explain the explosion of Christianity so that Jerusalem was filled? Notice chapter 17, last verse. Chapter 17 and verse 6. Not only did they fill Jerusalem with their doctrine, but notice in verse 6 this. And when they had found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, these that have turned the world upside down are come down hither. How do you explain that apart from the resurrection? You can't. It is impossible. Five reasons to believe in the resurrection. The resurrection proved that God was satisfied, that the payment of sin that Jesus made was satisfactory for sin. Now, not everybody's going to heaven. Not everybody's going to heaven. I'll guarantee you that the devil believes in the resurrection of Christ. I'll guarantee you that demons believe in the resurrection of Christ. Are they going to heaven, preacher? No. Say, well, who's going to heaven? Those that have accepted what Jesus did for them on the cross that made that payment. For there is no other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. It's not, well, you can be, possibly be. Well, it's an option anyway. You must be saved. Remember that day? Do you remember that day? Oh, happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. What a day that was because of the resurrection. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits. And because Christ lives, we too shall live. Solomon, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, we're not going to look at it because we're through. Solomon uses death as a euphemism in this way. Ere the silver cord breaks. One day, you and I will cross the river to the other side. What a day that will be. For those of us who have trusted Christ, who know Him as Savior, what a great day that's going to be. We're going to see Mom and Dad and Grandma and people that I don't even know. Going to see David. I'm reading about David now. David, John the Baptist. What a great day that'll be. Because of the resurrection. Because He lives, you too shall live. Let me ask you this question. We're through. Have you trusted Christ? Do you know that heaven's your home? Are you on your way to heaven? Let's pray. Father, we thank You again. Now, Lord, for another opportunity today to come and be in church, to Lord, to speak. And Lord, I thank you for each one of these dear folks who are here today, Lord. Father, I mean this, they honor me with their presence today, that they would come to church to hear me is beyond me. Lord, I thank you that they did, and Lord, I wanted to say today what you wanted me to say. And so, Father, I pray that you'll encourage us today. We serve a risen Savior. Lord, you're not dead. You're alive. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for that day when we bowed our head and bowed our knee and admitted what great sinners we were. And Lord, that we needed to be saved. And Lord, we trusted you. What a great day that was. As Jesus said to Martha, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. How we thank you for that. Lord, I pray for anyone who may be here. Lord, I don't know anybody's heart but my own, but Lord, if there's someone here today that's not sure about heaven, Lord, I pray you'll speak to their heart. Lord, help them to understand that eternal life is a free gift, not to be earned, but it's something to be received. All they have to do is receive it. All they have to do is ask. They don't have to join the church. They don't have to give money. They don't have to be baptized. All they have to do is ask. Lord, help us, we pray. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Nobody looking around. We're through. I mean it. We are. Is there anyone here today as we close, and we are closing, is there anyone here today who would say this, preacher, I'm not sure that I would go to heaven when I die. I'm not sure about that. Look, you think about it for a minute. I am not sure I would go to heaven. Can't be any simpler than that. If you're not sure, I'd like to pray for you. That's all I want. I'm not going to come back. You know me. You say, well, I've been here 100 times. I don't care. I'm not sure I would go to heaven. I'd just like to pray for you. If I can pray for you, if you'd slip your hand up. Now, nobody's looking. We're not on TV anymore. Is there anybody who say, preacher, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. And I'd like to know that. Would you please pray for me? Slip your hand up. I'll see it. All I want to do is pray for you. Is there one? Preacher, I am not sure I would go to heaven. I can remember sitting in church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. The preacher giving the invitation. Do you know for sure you're going to heaven? I didn't know that. But the Holy Spirit was tugging at my heart. Friend, if the Holy Spirit's tugging at your heart today, may I pray for you? Anyone? Preacher, pray for me. I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. Father, I don't see any hands today. So, Lord, help us as we leave today rejoicing in our great salvation. Lord, for the resurrection of Christ from the dead, knowing that we have a home in heaven, that we're going to be there in the sweet by and by we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Lord, bless us, we pray. Help us, we ask. And, Lord, we'll thank and praise you for all that you're going to do for us in thy holy and precious name. Amen. And amen.